Ephesians chapter 1. From Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by God's will. God's holy and faithful people who are united with Christ in the city of Ephesus. Goodwill and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ are yours. To God's holy and faithful people who are united. Other versions say who are called. I want to zero in on the fact that God's people are called. If you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you are called. Do you know that? You are called. If you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you are called. And as we get into the book of Ephesians and study the book of Ephesians, you're going to see that you are called not to just sit and come on Sunday morning. You are called. You have a ministry. You are called to a ministry. You're not called to just come on Wednesday night or Sunday night. You are called to a ministry. You have a ministry, Dave. You have a ministry, John. You have a ministry, George. You have a ministry, Lacey. You have a ministry, Sharon. You have a ministry, Thomas. You have a ministry, Jerry. We have a ministry. If we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, we have been called by God. That's exciting. That is something that God, who created everything, who holds it in his hands, Elohim, God, Jehovah Jireh, God, Jehovah Shalom, God, Adonai, God, calls me. Me. All of my problems, all of my shortcomings, all of my, watch it, Alice, you're enjoying this too much. All of my, God still calls me. Woo, bless the Lord. Book of Jonah, chapter 4. Book of Jonah, chapter 4. You there? And we're going to sit in this story for the next couple weeks. Jonah, chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. Jonah was very upset about this, and he became angry. So he prayed to the Lord. Lord, isn't this what I said would happen when I was still in my own country? That's why I tried to run to Tarsus in the first place. I knew. I told you so. I knew you were going to do this. I knew that you are a merciful and compassionate God, patient and always ready to forgive and to reconsider your threats of destruction. You ever told the Lord those types of things? And Jonah was pretty brave, wasn't he? I mean, think about it. He's talking to God. God, isn't this what I said would happen? I knew it. So now, Lord, take my life, because I'd rather be dead than alive. So the Lord asked, what right do you have to be angry? Jonah left the city and sat down east of it. Pulled up his easy chair, reclined it, got a shelter, got his iced tea, bag of popcorn, sat in the shade and waited to see what would happen to the city. I mean, I kind of embellished a little bit. He says that he made a shelter there, right? Got something comfortable, right? sat in the shade and waited to see what was going to happen. Isn't that it? The story of Jonah gives us some characters to which Jonah is the chief. I mean, he's the main character. And the story, if you go back to the beginning of the book of Jonah, the story starts with Jonah at the marina. And he's making a choice between two directions, two opinions. And we know that he is God's man. God has called him. Every believer that has a relationship with God has a call on their lives. God has called him. We know God has called him. And God has prepared him to use him to enact his will against the people. His will being God's will. We must realize that God does not call us to our own agenda. Oh, we think so. We think so, but we must realize that God does not call us to our own agenda to accomplish what we think is meaningful or purposeful. And this is quite clear in the story of Jonah. He calls us according to his divine will and dispatches us as servants and instruments that God's purpose might be executed in the earth. That's God's call on our lives. But even though he is sovereign, even though he is absolute, and he is God all by himself, in the midst of him calling us to do his will, he has, in his grace and wisdom, included within each one of us our own will, and respects our will to the degree that he allows us to make choices. And therein lies the trouble, doesn't it?
Amen.
It would have been better if he would have made us like robots, where he could program us to do certain things and we would just do them without any human involvement. And because when our human will gets into the mix against God's will, the option creates chaos, doesn't it?
Yeah, amen.
Most of the time. And it often delays the process. There have been many times that I've missed the mark that I should have hit years ago because I detoured, and when I detoured, it brought about a commercial in my life where I should have been. It flashed in my will. There was something that flashed in my will that suggested that perhaps I should go a different way, a thought that came into my mind, like we've been talking about on Wednesday nights, that I acted on and I made a choice. I had a good running car. It used a little more gas than I liked, so I thought I would trade it in on a little more economical car. The finances didn't work out very well, but I finagled it, and I bought a lemon. I should have kept the good running car. And I took a commercial and a detour, and I missed the mark. And I paid for that little car, that little gas, and it ended up costing me three times the price if I just kept the bigger car and paid a little more in gas. Because the bigger car was running well. There was nothing wrong with it. It just used a little more gas than what I wanted. So we start the story today at the marina because I want us to see that there are many options and there are in life every boat goes in different directions, but it's all from the same port. It's all from the same starting place. And you have the right and you have the power within yourself to choose the direction that you want to go. But in the process of making that choice, that God is sovereign, and when everything is said and done, he will have his way.
Amen.
Jonah's story is a tale of two cities. He's debating about going to one of the two cities, Nineveh and Tarshish. Nineveh is where God wants him to go. Tarshish is where he has decided to go as an act of his own will. God's will or my will. God's will or my will. And he decides, I'm going to go in my own way. And he does. And he buys a ticket to go to Tarshish. And God does not stop him. He puts his bags on the boat. God does not stop him. He gets settled into his cabin, unpacks his bags, puts it in the little dresser there, and God does not stop him. He goes to the buffet that's provided there on the boat, and God does not stop him. Plays a game of shuffleboard on the deck, and God does not stop him. And they set sail successfully, and God... You have to have creative imagination.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, can't you see it? Can't you see it happening? Right? Yeah, okay. They set sail successfully, and God does not stop it. But there's a lesson here for us, that just because you are able to go forward, it does not mean that you are right. The silence of God does not mean that you have changed his mind. Neither does it suggest that you are in his permissive will. In reality, he is respecting your right to choose. Because when you choose another direction other than his, this is a teaching opportunity for God. Proverbs 14:12 says, there is a way that seems right to a person, but eventually it ends in death. Notice that it ends in death. Not the beginning. So it can start out good, but if you're not careful, it will end up at death. Even though you are able to execute it in its origin, you will not be able to tolerate it in its destiny. Because somewhere along the way of the human will, a storm will always come up. Jonah starts out for Tarshish, and everything is looking good. And we've heard the story many times. And he goes out further along the way, into his own way, into his human will, and a storm arises. A fierce storm. So chaotic and so dangerous that he puts into jeopardy everyone connected to him. And what we have to understand is that when you belong to God, everybody can sail into a direction and have no turbulence at all. But when you try to do what everybody else is doing because you belong to God, what others get away with, you will not be able to get away with. There's nothing wrong with the boat. There's nothing wrong with the people on the boat. There's nothing wrong with the captain of the ship. But when you got on the boat, you changed the dynamics because you are not your own. You are bought with a price. You are chosen by God. You are a royal priesthood, selected from the foundations of the world. And though he respects your human will, he will ultimately prevail over your human will. And that's what makes him God. Jesus said it this way, not my will, but thine be done. Jonah operates in his will effectively for a while. But ultimately, he puts everybody in the boat in jeopardy. Because in the process of executing his own will, God sends a storm. He's not after the captain. He's not after the cargo. He's not after the people on the boat. He's not even after the buffet line. God has only one interest in the whole storm, and he will shake up everything to get one person. He will send chaos. He will allow damage to be done on the boat. He will allow cargo to be lost. He will allow others to become hysterical. Because he's after one person. And the moment they finally figure out that there's nothing wrong with the captain, there's nothing wrong with the boat, there's nothing wrong with the steering, there's nothing wrong with the ropes, there's nothing wrong with the workers, there's nothing wrong with the passengers, except we have one person on board who has angered God in the spirit of his rebellion, and they got rid of Jonah. Tossed him off the boat, and the storm ceased, because the storm said, I'm not after you or you or you or you or you, I want him. And the moment that they were separated from him, the storm stopped, and God said, storm, rest. I don't need you anymore. And he sends a great fish who swallows up Jonah, and Jonah goes into the hell that all of us go through. When we have selected the wrong path and thought we had gotten away from God, and God was still there. The Bible says that Jonah purposed himself that he would flee the presence of God. What a childish thing to do, isn't it? It's kind of silly, actually, that you think you can run from the presence of God. It's really kind of funny. It makes you think why God would even use someone who would talk like that in the first place. Because anyone in their right mind would think, where would you go to flee the presence of God? I mean, think about it seriously. Think about it logically. God's presence is not just in his purpose. God's presence is not just in Nineveh. God's presence is not just in right. God's presence is in wrong. God's presence is not just in holiness. God's presence is in hell. God's presence is not just in church. God's presence is in the casino. Oh, woke some of you up with that word, didn't I? David wrote in Psalm, in the book of Psalms, if I go up to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. And there Jonah is in his hellish situation. Do you know you don't have to go to hell to live in hell?
Amen.
You don't have to die and be cursed to a lake of fire and burn forever and ever. You don't have to die at all. You can wake up in the morning and find yourself in a hell that is made up of a series of bad decisions that you brought on yourself.
Amen.
Don't blame the devil for this. Don't curse the demons for this. This is not the work of Satan or a witch. This is just you having it your way. You went to Burger King. There is a way that seems right to a person, but eventually it ends in death. Jonah finds himself swallowed up in the belly of a fish, and the fish goes down to the bottom of the mountains, and there Jonah finds himself at the bottom of the mountains. At the bottom of the mountains. The bottom of high places. What an oxymoron, isn't it? Bottom of high places. The extremes that are there. Mountains peaking at the top, but Jonah at the bottom. Have you ever felt like you were at the bottom of a mountain? You could see where you couldn't go. You could see where others operating at a level that you weren't operating in. You were close enough to see it, but you were at the bottom of it. There he was wrestling for 3 days. Wrestling to say yes to God. Wrestling to say yes to his will. Wrestling to say yes to his word. Wrestling to make the right choice. You see, this is a second chance in a worse place. You could have made it from a place of comfort. On the dock before you left. But because you didn't say yes up there, the second chance comes from a hellish place. Sometimes you can say no in church, and the next time you get a chance to say yes, you're in a hospital bed. But sooner or later, God will have His way. Whether you are rich or you are broke, God will have His way. Whether you are healthy or you are sick, God will have His way. Because when you belong to God, God will have His way. Jonah says in Jonah 2:2 that from the depths of my hell, I cried to the Lord, and He heard me. Oh, bless the Lord. He cried from the bottom of the mountains. And not only did God send him into a hell, but He heard him in the hell he was in. Oh, bless the Lord. Have you ever had to be heard in hell? It's nice when you could pray at the altar of the church. Oh, that's good. With the preacher nearby and the oil there to anoint you and the praise team singing and people all around you. But sometimes you have to pray in a hellish situation. Lord, if you get me out of this. I know that you've never had to pray those kinds of prayers, but I've prayed those simple, frantic prayers. I know I brought this on myself, God. I know you told me not to do this. I know that if I would have obeyed you, I wouldn't be in this mess. But Lord, I love you, and I love you wrong. I love you in my wrong. I love you in my weakness. I love you in my chaos. I love you in my confusion. And I'm telling you right now, even disobedient, even rebellious, even in the hellish situation, even at the bottom of the mountain, even laying here in all this fish gut, I'm still your child. I may be your crazy child. I may be your prodigal child. I may be your confused child. I may be your disobedient child, but I'm still your child. Oh, have you ever had to remind God that I'm still your child? I don't look like I'm your child. I don't act like I'm your child. I don't smell like I'm your child. But even down here in all this fish gut, I'm still not like what I'm surrounded by, but I'm your child. I'm still your child. And if you read the story close enough, God heard his cry. And so God began to speak to that great fish. And now notice, many of us say it was a whale. But the Bible doesn't say it was a whale. The Bible says it was a great fish. So we need to get our facts straight. All right? I just want to clarify that right now. It was a great fish. God heard him, and God began to speak to that great fish and gave that great fish indigestion. And it was the kind of indigestion that made him regurgitate everything that he had eaten. What a beautiful sight. I'm 50. I have a procedure tomorrow. What a beautiful sight. That fish got indigestion, and God gave that fish indigestion just to get Jonah out. Oh, church, when you get into a trap and you belong to God and you finally say yes, the way you're supposed to say yes, whatever God has to shake up to get you out of that situation, God will get you out of it. There are a few people in here that can testify that there are some, and there are some in here that could but won't. There are some close calls, some narrow escapes, then near mishaps that if the Lord had not stepped in and shook up the whole system to get them out of the mess, they would have been utterly destroyed. There are some that think we praise God because we're emotional. But you see, the real reason why we praise God is because we almost died in something that God snatched us out of. And we owe Him the praise for the things that He has done. I was wondering, can all the grateful people in here this morning give God a praise right now? All the close call, narrow escape, all the coulda, woulda, shoulda people, give God a praise right now. Oh, you see, because God carried us out. God shook it up. All this was brought about by Jonah's intimidation to go to Nineveh. When you think about it, Jonah must have been pretty gifted and competent. Think about it, Cody. You're studying to be a preacher. We meet on Thursdays. You're seeking ordination. Jonah must have been pretty gifted and competent. When you study about what Nineveh was, the city of Nineveh, God must have had a lot of confidence in him just to send him to Nineveh. That's kind of crazy, wouldn't you say so, Dad? Just to send one man to Nineveh? Because if it were me, and I've worked with Billy Graham, the Billy Graham Crusade, and I know how they work, there would have been a whole team of people going to Nineveh. I mean, we're talking about a great city. There were walls surrounding the city that were 50 feet high. It was a strong and progressive city. It was a city without equal in its era. There were waterways and conduits to transport water throughout the city. No other city had that. Think about it. It was way ahead of its time. It was way ahead of it. Nineveh was a progressive city. It took 3 days' journey just to walk from one side of the city to the other side of the city. 3 days. And God sends one man. It was a great and powerful city filled with hundreds and thousands of people. It had economic strength and power. Other nations had feared Nineveh. Nineveh had been a terror to the Hebrew people. A terror. That's why Jonah didn't want to go. I mean, can you imagine? I'd be scared to death. You want me to do what? Go to where? And tell them what? They need to repent? Because you're going to destroy them? Yeah, I'm going to Tarsus. Sure. It wasn't the walls. It wasn't the water. It wasn't the economics. It was the fact that Nineveh had been an enemy to his people. And Jonah had a personal opinion about Nineveh that was contrary to the purpose of God. Jonah was racist. He could just come down to it, call it what it was. He didn't like the Ninevites. He was racist. He didn't want to go. The thing about this is that God doesn't need you to agree with Him to accomplish His purpose. Oh, I want to say that again because we need to let that sink in, church. God doesn't need you to agree with Him to accomplish His purpose. Because it's not about you. God will accomplish His purpose because He's God, whether we agree with Him or not. Did you hear that? He's God, whether we agree with Him or not. We have a problem with that in our society today. He's God, whether we agree with Him or not. Boy, y'all got quiet. Let me back out of that. Jonah's thought was, what was the use of preaching to them anyway? Many scholars believe that Nineveh's founder was Nimrod. Nimrod was the rebellious one who shook his fist in God's face and tried to build a tower to heaven. They were rooted in rebellion against God. Why go down there and talk to stubborn people? Bite my tongue. Why go down there and talk to stubborn? Why should I say yes when I've already figured out it ain't going to work, God? Am I not smarter than God? Doesn't God know who Nimrod is? Doesn't God know about the walls around that city? Doesn't God know that the people in Nineveh are just consumed with themselves? Doesn't that sound like the United States of America today? Doesn't God know that I don't even like them? Wow, I've heard some of those comments today. What do you do when God sends you to talk to somebody you don't like? Wow, you all got real quiet when we started touching on this. What are you going to do when God leads you past the comfort of your friends here to talk with somebody you may not like out there? To talk with someone who isn't like you, who doesn't smell like you, who isn't your age, who doesn't think like you, who likes different things than you. Do you have the dexterity of character of being flexible enough to operate in the spirit of excellence when you don't have a personal vested interest in the person he sends you to? Remembering that it's not about you. It's not about your interests. It's not about your comfort. It's about God's will being accomplished. It's about the kingdom of God. It's about the gospel being shared. Point blank, it's about God, isn't it? Will we have the spirit of excellence? Jonah has to go to Nineveh to preach to Nineveh. That's the assignment. That's God's purpose. That's God's will. That's what he's told to do. He must have been some kind of preacher to go to a city that was so powerful, that was thousands of years ahead of its time. God sends one man, no microphone, no sound system, no radio broadcast, no internet, no TV. One man with one voice so small that he couldn't even holler from one end of the city to the other. But God says, I want you to go there. And I want you to stand right in the middle of the city and say, repent. Because in 40 days, God is going to tear this city apart. And by the way, the God I'm talking about is not your God. They don't worship him. They don't serve him. They don't seek him. They worship a female goddess that has nothing to do with Jehovah. It is going to be your God against theirs. And God says, I want you to go there and say, repent, or in 40 days, or the God you don't believe in is going to tear your city down. What an assignment. Would you take it up? Has God ever sent you to do something that the odds were against you? You were out of your comfort zone. You were out of your element. You had no leverage in this arena. The things that you were good at were not respected. And yet God sent you in there with a message that was objectionable at best. And you had to deliver the message on foot. A message with a time component attached to it. A certain time period to get things done. A message that you could not be slack in delivering. A message that if you don't respond with a certain period of time, there will be utter destruction. Church, I want to tell you something. There is a message that God has given us that there is a time component put on it. The Bible says, redeem the time while there is still time. God said, Jesus said, go into all of the world and spread the gospel, because he is coming back. And when he does come back, that's the end. Do you know when he's coming back? No. It could be today. Guess what? There's a time component, and we got feet, and we need to get out, and we need to be sharing the gospel. There is a time component, and in the end, there will be utter destruction. What are you going to do when the clock is ticking and you are running out of time? God has sent you, and the odds are against you. There is a battle that is going on, and the odds are against you. It was against all of that that God sent Jonah to Nineveh. But that isn't what gets me going about this story. What gets me going about this story is that the guy who is preaching in Nineveh today was in the belly of the fish a few days ago. And this text is attracting, and it should be exciting for each one of us. Because the irony that you can find there is that Jonah is telling people to repent when he just got through repenting himself. That's exciting, isn't it? There's not much difference between the preacher and the pew in this story. This is what people don't like to tell you. There's not much difference between the one talking and the one writing the notes. Jonah is asking people to repent, and he just got through repenting himself. Jonah is calling out their sins, but it was a sin when you took the wrong boat, Jonah. Jonah is not preaching in his name. He's preaching in the name of his God. And God sends a sinner after a sinner. Woo! Bless the Lord. He sends a rebellious prophet to pronounce judgment on a rebellious city. But y'all can start talking again. Okay? Y'all start talking again. That's exciting. And says to the prophet, I'm not going to let you go until you do what I said. Even though you were infected with the same thing you are trying to cure, I'm going to snatch you out of that, of the same mess they're into. I'm still going to send you and tell them what I said. Now you know, we would have felt better about this if his sin would have been a few years ago. You know how we church folk are about sins, aren't we? Huh? We like them when they're old. You only give your testimony after it's old. You only allow people to stand up and give their testimony when they say, well, you know, 28 years ago, God snatched me out. And he put my feet on the straight and narrow. I praise his holy name today. I don't know where I'd be right now if the Lord hadn't snatched me out, but back when I was 11. But people don't want to hear, yeah, a little longer than 20 years ago. Remind me, I'm 50. But people don't want to hear that I just got out of trouble myself. But God has sent me to this great and terrible city saying, repent! It would have made sense that Jonah's guilt would have hindered him preaching. But no, the guilt was swallowed up by the gift that God had given him. And out of his extreme giftedness, he functioned without regard to personal feelings or circumstance. And in obedience, he cries out judgment against a city to which he had so much in common himself. Ironically, the vaccination, the cure, the serum is often made from the same bacteria. There must be some kinship between the Redeemer and the redeemed. Isn't Jesus our kinsman Redeemer? That's why God drove God. That is what drove God to come in the flesh, in the form of Jesus, because he needed to be kin to what he sought to redeem. He became our kinsman Redeemer. Until you have been touched by the very thing you are trying to fix, you won't have the right perspective to bring about a change. If you've never been down, if you've never been broke, if you've never been sick, if you've never been weak, if you've never been wrong, if you've never been crazy, you can't help people if you haven't been in a similar dilemma yourself. But if you've been there, then you can help others out. Let me tell you something, church. Jesus has been there, and he can help you out. The writer of Hebrews says it like this: for we have not a high priest in which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Church, he knows my need. He knows me. He knows what I'm going through. He knows what you're going through. And he will touch that need today. He knows where you are, even if you're at the bottom of the mountain in a pile of fish guts. And he'll touch that need today. Because he is our kinsman, Redeemer. Jesus is. Now we're going to leave Jonah there till next week. But what do you need Jesus to do for you today? Maybe you're standing on the dock today, about to make a choice. If you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you are called. You are called, old and young. You are called today. And middle-aged, you are called today. What choice are you going to make? Is he calling you to Nineveh? You want to run to Tarsus? I'm telling you, he will send a storm, because God will have his way. He will accomplish his purpose. If he has to use a storm, if he has to use a great fish, or if he has to use a donkey. And the donkey has to open his mouth and speak to you on the trail. He will have his way. And you have the opportunity right now to make that choice here. Or make that choice in the storm and in the fish. What will you choose? He knows where you are. He knows your need. He knows the struggle, mentally, physically, and spiritually. And he can touch it today and meet that need. Doesn't mean the struggle goes away, but you have new strength to accomplish purpose and go to Nineveh and preach the gospel and accomplish his purpose.